Hello, everyone. Good evening. It is such a pleasure to say hello to all of you. Thank you for tuning in. And I have a very special guest, my favorite art historian from Florence, Dottoressa Cristina Accidini, with us from Florence.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Paola. And thank you for this invitation.
Thank you for saying yes, Cristina. I remember really well when I heard you speak for the first time. It was in Basilica of Santa Croce in 2006. And I was, you know, just new in Florence, starting my graduate degree. And I thought this was absolutely amazing. You were talking about the tomb of Galileo Galilei in the church. And I still remember that lecture, even though it was 14 years ago. So I know that we are in for a treat tonight. Now, can you see all of us? Can you see we are a big group of people?
Yeah, I see. I'm very happy to have such an audience on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean. It's an honor for me and a challenge at the same time. Let me apologize first for my English, because as almost everybody in the world, I can't travel, I can't meet people, so I'm out of training, and I hope you will understand me anyhow.
You know what, Cristina, your English is absolutely perfect. I would love to ask everyone, if you can mute yourselves, please, that way there will be no interference as Cristina gives us her lecture. Cristina, I just wanted to ask you, you have had this incredible career. You were in charge of all the Florentine state museums for 14 years. And right now you're the president of the Accademia delle Arti del Disegno. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit just about the Accademia? Because it was such an incredible institution in the city of Florence.
Oh, thank you for this question. I'm really very affectionate to the Accademia, because it is the seems to be the oldest artistic academy in the world, or at least in the Western world. We don't know so much about China, but it seems that it has been founded in 1563 in the name of Michelangelo Buonarroti, the great artist, by the Duke Cosimo de' Medici and his favorite artist, Giorgio Vasari, the one who wrote the Lives of the Artists. So this is the first academy to take care of the artists, not only of literature, poetry, or philosophy, but art. And they, since the very beginning, started doing art, reflecting on the arts, and debating on the arts, and still we do that. So it's incredibly interesting to be in this structure that is a complex one, because we have art historians, scientists, writers, as well as the architects, painters, sculptors, and they are supposed to same goals and to do things together and to have an impact on the arts of these nowadays societies.
Cristina, can you tell us a little bit about your pin, which is basically also the logo, the logo of the Accademia?
Yes, I'm very proud to wear it. When I entered the Academia, the women were not so many, and I'm the first woman president, so that I show it proudly. And the three crowns intertwined, how do you pronounce
it? Intertwined, uh-huh.
Intertwined, they are the symbol of many things together. First of all, they symbolize the three arts, the main arts of the time, architecture, painting, and sculpture. And then there is a symbol in a religious layer that is the Trinity, three persons, God the Father, Christ, and the Holy Ghost. And eventually, Michelangelo used a symbol very similar to these three circles, and he used to carve the symbol on the pieces of marble that he was supposed to use for himself. So Giorgio Vasari decided to have these three circles to be transformed into three crowns, and that's what they are since almost five centuries.
What a great logo. You know, Giorgio Vasari was such an incredible visionary.
Yes, he was a very modern, a contemporary man. He had a vision of the future of the arts, and also of the upgrading of the society, of the artists within the society. And that was pioneering idea.
True. Christina, what will be your first project when the world goes back to normal? What will you do in the academia?
I will be very happy to show what we have been doing in those last months. We have been preparing, thanks to the architects of the academia, who really had a very good idea and made a very good project. We are going to open a sort of museum room where three works of art are together. It's already there. It can be open anytime, but we can't do that now. And the highlight is a model, life size, that Michelangelo created in order to show to the sculptors in the Medici Chapel in San Lorenzo how to sculpt the figure of a river god. River god is a symbol of the territory, is a symbol of power, is an ancient mythical figure that comes from the Roman and even before from the Greek art. And so Michelangelo did it by himself with his hands, using very poor material, wire, mud, clay, gypsum, and then painted white. And that was the idea of a marble statue. It's so incredibly energetic, so incredibly powerful. Although this model doesn't have his head, it was never done. And it was useless. At a certain point of the story of the new sacristy of the Medici, with the Medici tomb in San Lorenzo, this project was abandoned. Michelangelo went away from Florence. He reached Rome in 1534, and he was never to go back to Florence.
Back.
He stayed in Rome until the end of his long life. So we consider this river god a sort of very noble and fascinating leftover. It was something that the Duke Cosimo didn't know what to do with. So he presented this huge sculpture to Bartolomeo Mannati, one of his favorite architects of the court, of the Medici court. And he, Mannati, who didn't have a family of his own, he was childless, didn't have heirs, gifted this to the academy. So it is with us since 1582. And it's funny to think that it has been moved here and there, following the academia in the various premises and palaces where the academia was based in the centuries, and eventually was almost lost. It was confused among the other sculptures in the Academia of Fine Arts, and then identified and brought back to his home, so to say. So we just wait for opening the door, switching on the lights, and welcoming people in.
So Christina, will that room actually be open to visitors?
Oh, we are working for that purpose. Of course, we had to remake our plans and to rethink about the ways it can be done. We rely on the safest procedures, that is to open the doors for groups, small groups of people that, of course, can be, you know, safe inside.
Okay. Interesting.
Sooner or later, we'll do that.
You know, if we can trust Vasari, who said that Michelangelo destroyed all of his models before he died because he didn't want people to know how hard he worked, this river god is even more of a gift.
Yeah, it is a survivor, really. It's a miracle that it came to us.
Yes. Christina, you also recently curated an exhibition on Michelangelo, and I see a poster behind you.
Yes, this poster is, of course, now the exhibition is not visible. It is closed and we wait for better times to reopen it in the Ducal Palace of Genova.
Wow.
And it's entirely devoted to Michelangelo from the point of view of the incredibly important person that he met throughout his long life. Because of course, Michelangelo is a genius, is a titanic character, but maybe he would have been a simple lawyer or secretary unless he was meeting people that helped him to achieve his own talents. And the first was a neighbor, Francesco Granacci, a young boy that was 5 years more older than he was. And he encouraged him and somehow convinced Michelangelo's father, Ludovico Buonarroti, who was totally against an artistic career for his son. And he convinced Ludovico to let Michelangelo follow this sort of destiny. So we are thankful to Francesco Granacci, but of course also to Lorenzo il Magnifico, the Medici patron, and then the popes, and then the King of France, who was in touch with Michelangelo. He was incredibly important in the European scene, Michelangelo, I mean. And when he was very, very old, it was the year before he died, he was 88, the Queen of France wrote to him in order to obtain a monument of his beloved spouse, Henry II, who passed during an accident in a duel. And she was begging Michelangelo. Now, can you imagine a queen who begs an artist? And that makes Michelangelo's life a sort of a never-ending source of surprises and a wonderful story in itself. And Michelangelo would encourage a myth of himself as a lonely man, but he was not lonely at all. He was not alone. He was full of friends and patrons and enemies also. And so he was living all by himself, but surrounded by people who took care of him.
True, very true. I think I saw a letter. I think it was the King of France who was asking Michelangelo to do something for him. And he said, you know, I'm so old and I have so many projects. I will see if I can do something for you in the afterlife. If I can work from up above, I definitely promise to do something.
Yes. So, can you imagine an artist to write such a letter?
Yes.
One of the favorite documents is a document written by a notary. Is it right? A notaio.
Notary, yes.
Mm-hmm. It is in Italian. And at the end, the notary writes, I should have used Latin as we usually do, but I couldn't because this man did not let me use the Latin language. He said, we speak Italian, you have to write the contract in Italian so that I can understand. Wow. So can you imagine such a breaking rules every second minute.
Yes, incredible. You know, I think we can talk about Michelangelo, but maybe let's leave that for another meeting, okay? Maybe when the exhibition is open in Genova, maybe we can go through with you visually or virtually through it.
I hope so, yes.
Yes. I think that behind you have two really beautiful heirlooms. Can you tell us just a little bit about the Buon Natale and the patchwork that is visible?
Both of them are works made by my mother, who used to be extremely gifted and talented in the arts of the needle, so to say. And so she was both sewing patchwork works with a great attention for the American kilts and other arts and craft of this kind. And also she was practicing crosswork, cross stitch. And even making experiments, as you see in the Buon Natale and Merry Christmas card, with tiny glass beads. She was sewing with an incredible passion and skilled. Unfortunately, I'm not like her at all. I'm not able to do that. But I like to have these souvenirs of her talent.
And especially at this time of the year.
Yes, yes. I miss her terribly. And I surround myself with her works in order to have her in my mind and under my eyes.
Yes. And, oh, so precious. So it's really beautiful in Florence this time of the year. I was just telling everyone how decorations around the city are even more special somehow this year. And I'm so glad that you said yes to share with us your favorite works of adoration of the Magi, which for the Florentines was a very important concept even back in the Renaissance. So
can you imagine? I didn't want to interrupt, but there was a sudden memory. When I was a child, that is not 1,000 years ago after all, Christmas was important, but the Epiphany, the day of the Magi, was even more important. And the presents were given that day instead of Christmas.
Interesting.
Day. Yes, yes, yes. It was a very strong tradition.
You know, in my culture, my Christmas comes on January 7th because I'm Orthodox. And, you know, Greek Orthodox. So when I have a procession in the city of Florence on the 6th, I always feel like, you know, it's my Christmas. And so it's doubly special for me, you know. Anyway, so Christina, I think I will give it now all the screen to you so you can share your images with us. I ask everyone who is with us to put the questions in the chat, and then we will come back to all the questions at the end. Does that sound good?
And please tell me if I'm speaking too long.
No, don't worry. Don't worry.
So here we are in the company of the Magi. That means at least two things, that we are together with the Magi, but we also will speak about a very special institution in Renaissance Florence, that was the company and the guild of the Magi that were associated to the Medici. So we will show paintings and we'll comment upon them that involved two great families, Strozzi and Medici, and families that were rivals in the competitive frame of Florence in the 15th century. Now, what you see is the Church of Santa Trinita with a Baroque facade, and you see the sacristy, apparently an empty place, and that it is now rather empty. But at that time, at the very beginning of the 15th century, it was literally enlightened and embellished by this wonderful panel painting, the Adoration of the Magi, painted in 1423 by Gentile da Fabriano for the Strozzi family. Now is in the galleries of the Uffizi, as many other paintings coming from the Florentine churches, but it used to be a beloved image of, and of course, a work of art that the Strozzi family was very proud of. Who was Gentile da Fabriano? As the name itself says, he came from Fabriano, a small city in the very heart of Italy. But he was extremely appreciated in Florence. And Palla Strozzi, Palla is a strange name, but that's the name of the head of the family at the time, was the patron of this wonderful painting that you see still has its frame. And it's predella, the stripe where the small stories are painted. So what is the subject? It's the Adoration of the Magi that happens after a long trip. The Magi are wise men and scientists, astronomers coming from East, joining at a certain point of their respective trips, and arriving together at the simple and humble hut where Jesus Christ is leaning with in the womb of his mother. And they present him with three symbolic gifts, gold, myrrh, and incense. Gold is for power, incense is for holiness, and myrrh is for the death, because the myrrh was used to embalm the corpses. So you see what's the interpretation of Gentile. It's incredibly gorgeous. You will see now some details of the scene. Madonna and Joseph are on the left, and two assistants, two women are also together with the Holy Family. And there's the donkey, that there is the
ox. Dog, the ox.
And they are the Magi. But the Magi are not by themselves. They have a wonderful court. Each of them have a court of gentlemen, of horsemen, of assistants that come with them. And they have been traveling with them all the way there. How are they presented? How are they imagined? Like kings, as they are. And they are dressed in wonderful brocades and alder silk garments. This shows, of course, the noble status of the kings, but also the incredible richness and power of the Strozzi family. Because as you see, the gold is lavishly present everywhere. And that means also that the panel painting was very expensive, as well as the frame, as all the details. You see from a closer point of view, which kind of magnificent fabric the dresses are made of, and how elegant and can I say courtiers almost those kings look like. And in usually those two men in the middle of the composition are supposed to be Palla Strozzi, the senior one, and his son Lorenzo, the one who is exactly in front of us. We're not sure of it because we have no way to compare those portraits with other portraits, but it's very probable that they are the Strozzi because they are exactly in the middle, and one of the two is staring at us. And you see the senior one had a falcon to show his, you know, his gentleman position, because the falconry was a hobby, a way of going after the birds and then the hares and other small preys in a noble way. As well, it's very noble to have the assistant that is conducted the horse. Yeah, the Strozzi, the so-called Strozzi, elegantly dressed. And then a very varied crowd of men following the Magi. And you see also two small monkeys and birds and even a leopard or something like that, or a cheetah or one of those and cats. And everybody's commenting upon what is happening. They are laughing, they are staring upwards because probably the star is shining in the sky. We don't have to remember the star that was leading the journey of the Magi. So some details, the horses, a wonderful greyhound, very elegant in his position, with a beautiful color, and one of the cats. So it means that during their journey, the Magi were also practicing chase. They were hunting after animals as gentlemen were supposed to do. This is all the animals that are together. And this is the upper part of the panel painting, just below the wonderful frame. And There's all the story. You see the Magi are arriving and joining and then meeting together and melting their respective companies. Then the very numerous group goes towards the castle of Herod, because before finding Jesus, the Magi were asking information to Herod. And it was something very full of consequences, because as soon as they asked if by chance Herod was informed of the birth of a king, King Herod get very nervous and suspicious, and then he, as we know, he ordered that the boys then were killed, the kids were killed. And then the Magi arrive in view of Bethlehem, and they eventually meet Madonna and Saint Joseph and Child Christ. Everything happens in a wonderful landscape, with the sea, with rocks, with castle, with vegetation. The fields are worked regularly, and everything is extremely accurate. Gentile didn't forget anything. You see the single scenes, how beautiful and rich of details they are, rich also of gold, by the way, and how picturesque this trip becomes with all those horses and noblemen and animals. And of course, the frame itself is devoted to sacred themes. So you see the Annunciation, the angel Gabriel is here on the left. On the right, you have the Virgin Mary. In between, there is Christ. And prophets are reading their prophecies in a pose that will be used later on by Ghiberti and by Michelangelo. It's a very beloved invention of Gentile. And this is the predella, with the small stories, a nativity, the flight into Egypt, and the presentation in the temple. The first two are in the Uffizi, and unfortunately the third was stolen, and that's the real word for it, by Napoleon Bonaparte, and is still in Paris, was never given back to Florence. You see how sweet is this image with the night, the holy night, enlightened by Jesus Christ as an infant and by the angel that gives the information to the shepherds that a savior is born. And also is very full of details, this wonderful scene of dawn, probably, when the holy family leaves to Egypt. You see the sun is a real half ball made with a mixture of gypsum and gilded in order to give the illusion of a volume coming out from the sky. Now, we're jumping to the other family. This is the Strozzi triumph, to have those wonderful works of art, that they were a very powerful family. And they were enemies of the Medici, especially of Cosimo, il Vecchio, the elder, that's the name that he would have had later, Cosimo, son of Giovanni, who was incredibly growing in the political scene. He was rich, and as many other Florentine of that time, he was a merchant, both a merchant and a banker. And slowly, the bank expanded to many other towns and cities of Europe. So the Medici became more and more powerful, so powerful that their enemies succeeded in having Cosimo exiled. He was in Padua and Venice, in other cities of North Italy, for 2 years, 1433 and 1434. But when he came back, he and his son, Piero il Gottoso, the Gauti, became the most important and relevant citizens of Florence, and the Strozzi family was defeated. somehow. They lost their power, their position. They were exiled, and they would come back later, two generations later. So the Medici won. The Medici won the political dominion. They won the cultural position. And with Lorenzo il Magnifico, the third of the Medici of the 15th century, they became the symbol of patronship and culture in Florence and in Italy. Now, one of the most relevant enterprises that Cosimo achieved once he came back from the exile, a very short and very comfortable exile, nevertheless, it was still an exile. He started to build the palace for himself and his family. Architecture is by Michelozzo di Bartolomeo. By the way, the first idea of Cosimo was to have as an architect Filippo Brunelleschi, who was building the dome of the cathedral. That means one of the most important symbols. You see it here, very small. The Cathedral of Florence. Can you see it? The dome of the cathedral. The most challenging enterprise in architecture and engineering of the whole century. Well, Filippo was building the dome, and Cosimo asked him to make a model for his palace. And as far as we know from Giorgio Vasari in the life of Brunelleschi, the model was so imposing, so gorgeous, so rich, that Cosimo was scared and say, no, I can't accept such a model, such a project, because my citizens would rebel against me again. And Filippo Brunelleschi was so angry at Cosimo that this is a legend perhaps, but it's told that he threw the model away from the window and had it destroyed. The second model that was used to build the construction was by Michelozzo di Bartolomeo, less genius, but more flexible architect. Now, if this is the result, can you imagine what the model by Brunelleschi should have been? A sort of king's house. This palace is also is very imposing and very rich. Inside the palace, there are many rooms, of course, and many works of art. And one of the works of art that were cherished by Cosimo and his son, Piero, was this tondo, circular painting, a panel painting of the round shape, Adoration of the Magi. At that time, the Medici were already the patrons of the Company of the Magi, an association of non-religious, but devout people that used to gather to make reunions near the Church of San Marco, within the Dominican Convent of San Marco, which was also under the protection of the Medici. And this painting was started by Beato Angelico, Fra Giovanni da Fiesole, called the Beato Angelico, who was also the painter in the convent of San Marco. Let's say something in brackets, a very short story in the story. The Pope, Eugenius IV, had problems in Rome and stayed in Florence for a while. And Cosimo, who was, of course, one of the most prominent citizens, was allowed to speak with him, to have conversations with the Pope, and asked, what can I do with all the money that I have? Maybe it was too much for him. He was ashamed. He was worried for his soul. And the Pope says, well, why don't you rebuild the convent of San Marco, where an order of monks, the Salvestrini, used to stay. The Salvestrini were moved not far from there, and the Dominican order who occupied the San Marco convent, and Cosimo de' Medici financed the whole reconstruction with the architecture of Michelozzo here too, and the painting of the common spaces as well, so the single rooms of the monks, frescoed by Beato Angelico, one of the most talented painters of the first years of the century. And in this convent, the Compagnia of the Magi was based. So everything is connected, you see. And if you imagine the shape of the center of Florence, from the convent of San Marco in Piazza San Marco now, and the Medici Palace in Via Larga, now Via Cavour, not far from the cathedral, a sort of walk of 15 minutes. So it means that the convent and the palace were connected very strictly. And so here we are again. Beato Angelico started this wonderful painting, but could not finish it. He died, or he went to Rome and then he died. And so another painter arrived to finish it, Filippo Lippi, another monk of another order, Carmelitan, very talented, very gifted, and very close to both Cosimo and his son Piero. But the result is, although they are two different painters in two different times, is amazing. The beauty of the crowd, of the dresses, of the attitudes, and also some curious inventions are here. For example, who are those nude men that you see on the ruined construction, on the ruined building? Maybe that Michelangelo himself was inspired by those nude men for his Holy Family in the Tondo Doni, but let Michelangelo stay out of this picture, otherwise we lose our track. And you see how beautiful this painting is, and we know that it was in the bedroom of Lorenzo il Magnifico when he used to sleep in the most comfortable room of the palace. This is a Madonna. And also very precious details are visible, such as the far away crowd, such as the peacock, the symbol of resurrection in sacred art, on the hat, and a falcon killing a duck. And all those precious details show that the Medici, in this case Cosimo especially, were very interested in competing with the splendor, with the magnificence of the Adoration of the Magi painted by Gentile da Fabriano for Palla Strozzi. But in the palace itself, something even more gorgeous and complex was to be painted. If you go from the courtyard by Michelozzo upstairs, and keep in mind that the stairs are more recent, they were built at the very end of the 17th century, we arrived to the chapel. The chapel of the Trinity, that we used to define the chapel of the Magi, because it's strongly characterized by the presence of the journey of the Magi. This wonderful drawing that an architect very gifted for this kind of images has been creating throughout the Passion studies shows the palace as a whole, the courtyard, the loggias, but also like a jewel within the walls of the palace, the chapel. The chapel, which is divided into two different rooms, although they are communicating, of course, too. But there's a main room and there's a small room. In the small space, only the priest can go to celebrate the mass. And in the rest of the chapel, of course, the family used to attend the rites. This is the plan of the palace on the second floor. And you see the yellowish area is the chapel. It's so small. It's really like a shrine within the walls of the palace. And here it is. Every detail has been carefully studied by Michelozzo. And
yes. Give mommy your AirPods, please.
Sorry, someone has. Voices. Sorry, can you unmute yourself, please? Let me see if I can be changed.
Yeah, here we are.
Okay. So, sorry, Christina. I'm trying to see who. Okay, I think
okay,
I.
Thanks. So, so you see, you can enjoy details wherever you put your eye on, because the ceilings are precious, the walls are magnificent, and we will comment upon them. The floor is precious as well. So everything has been carefully put together, probably spending a lot of money, much more than we think, for example, because in the floor there are pieces of ancient granite and porphyry, certainly coming from the ancient buildings of Rome. So you can appreciate how Cosimo il Vecchio was trying to show his magnificence to visitors, because this is the first private chapel in a palace in Florence. That means that he had to obtain a special permission from the Pope to have a sacred altar. But it's also a place where he used to receive people, to welcome people, and to open it as almost a public space. On the door, the original door, there is the lamb with the seven seals of the Apocalypse. And on the altar, there is an adoration of the child. But let's have a look to the precious details. This is wood, carved, gilded, and painted with the incredible lavish of gold. And there are also, if you can detect them, there are symbols of the Medici family. The crown around the symbol of San Bernardino, we call it the San Bernardino symbol, is three letters symbolizing Christ, rays like of the sun, plus a crown. And this crown is made of feathers, one of the symbols of the Medici family. Plus in the corners, there are rings, another symbol with diamonds, that are symbol of eternity, because the ring is round. It means that the time comes to, never comes to an end. It's only getting the same way forever. And the motto in the scroll is Semper, once again, eternity. So this is both sacred and profane image. As I told you before, the floor is fantastic. It is the first and only floor like that in Florence. And Filippo Lippi, beloved by the Medici, painted the panel painting on the altar that is now in Berlin, unfortunately, with the adoration of Christ, with the Madonna in prayer, the Holy Trinity appearing, because Christ the Father, the Holy Ghost, and Christ, they are the Trinity. That is exactly the dedication of the chapel. Plus you have San Bernard, and the infant Saint John, because Saint John was not only the cousin of Christ, but he was and is the patron saint of Florence. But what is really impressive in the chapel is what is painted on the wall of the main hall. It is the Journey of the Magi. And who did paint it? Not Filippo Lippi. Filippo Lippi was highly esteemed by the Medici, but he was working in Prato at that time, and he was busy with his family affairs because he had just, given birth to a son because of his love affair with the nun. So a very delicate moment for Filippo Lippi, with a happy hand, because the Pope allowed him to leave the status of religious vocation and to marry Lucrezia, the nun, and they became the happy parents of Filippino Lippi, a great painter himself. But that said, Filippo was busy and Angelico was dead. So the Medici had the idea, it probably was Cosimo's idea, to call back in Florence Benozzo Gozzoli, who was the most faithful and talented pupil of Angelico. And probably he told him something like, I want something really impressive. It has to be something that make people forget the Adoration of the Magi by Gentile da Fabriano, painted more than a quarter of a century earlier for Pallastrozzi. I want something that make Pallastrozzi disappear. And that was what he got after all. A wonderful mural painting full of stories in the story. I mean, there are the three Magi, of course, and they are symbols of the three ages of the men. And let's remember that at that time, Cosimo was senior, Piero was an adult, and Lorenzo, the first son of Piero, was a young boy. So maybe that the Magi symbolizes the Medici family and his destiny of glory. But let's see something closer. This is the most famous of the three Magi, perhaps, is Caspar, the younger. And there is a nice legend in Florence and not only that he represents Lorenzo, the future magnificent. Unfortunately, Lorenzo was not so handsome. He was, at that time, he was 10 years old, short, dark, and with an unpleasant face. And we know it for sure because he is portrayed in the crowd. But maybe that this young Magius is the symbol, the genius of the household, is the symbol of the family of the Medici. And as you see, he has a long company, a corteo, how can I say corteo?
Like a retinue.
Huh?
Retinue.
He has a very numerous retinues, and also horsemen and hunters are with him, and they are running after a deer in the landscape. So this wonderful image is full of details, as well as this one where the landscape is the real point of attraction. You see how wonderful is this hill with fields and woods and rivers and castle and very high trees in the foreground. In the sky, not by chance, a falcon is hunting a duck. So all those details recreate more or less the chivalry ambitions of the Medici family and of the noble families. Now, each of the Magi is followed by 12 followers. And this is very interesting. Because, I mean, no, they together are 12. They are 11 followers and one of the Magi. Because in the contemporary Florence, 12 was the number of the brigate, the so-called groups, the small gangs. They could gather, sometimes fight one against the other, and to play serenades to the girls, to make, you know, all that young people do, but not more than 12. So the Magi are traveling in companies that are formed by 12 people, both walking and riding. And, well, you see that something happened to these walls. There was an accident, a very, very heavy alteration that took place at the very end of the 17th century, when the new owners of the palace, the Marquis Riccardi, decided to have a larger staircase. And the original project was to destroy the chapel of the Trinity with these wonderful paintings. But in Florence, there was a strong movement against that. And the Academy, I'm proud of quoting the Academy of the Disegno, was totally negative about that. And eventually the Marquis Riccardi agreed to build a staircase that did not destroy the chapel, but only damage it. You see this corner is unnatural. It has been carved and remounted in a wrong way. Not all was lost. This small, one second back. This small wall was destroyed and a generic landscape was painted, but those figures were saved, as well as the rest of the journey of the Magi. Here you have the previous one was Baltasar, and this is Melchior, the senior one. And there is a belief that this journey represents the Council of Florence. That's a very interesting story because in 1439, Cosimo, in his full power and richness, succeeded in bringing the council that was at first reunited in Ferrara to Florence. So with the Greek priests, every sort of treasure arrived. They brought the texts of Plato, or the text of Aristotle's, of Plotino. That's how philosophy took over in Florence. It was a very important political and cultural success. And someone wrote first that these three Magi represent the council. And Balthasar would be the emperor, and Melchior would be the Orthodox patriarch, Giuseppe, who died in Florence, by the way. I don't know, it's always unpleasant to destroy beliefs, so I don't try to do that. But I think that the council is only a far memory in the background. What also was painted by Benozzo Gozzoli is this wonderful idea to use the small walls, really narrow stripes of walls, to paint the shepherds that in the Holy Night are wakened by the angel and they know that the Christ the Savior is born. And eventually in the small room where the altar is located, you have angels. On both walls, angels coming from the heaven, angels singing, angels praying, and angels working. We'll see which kind of work they're doing. So that's the very center of the image, as I was telling you, and everything is going towards the adoration of the child. Here is Caspar. Caspar is very, you know, very young and beautiful, handsome, and Lorenzo is not like that at all. This is Melchior, this is Baltasar, the one that usually is black in among the three Magi, and this is the senior Melchior. You see, the idea is more or less the same as in the Strozzi Adoration of the Magi. The idea of a mountain landscape full of curves where the retinues are going up, the gorgeous landscape here. And as I was telling you, the angels are working. They are gathering flowers and they're going to build festoons, these structures. They're very heavy and complex structures made with wires and branches and then flowers. And they were used in Florence to celebrate important festivities. And this is the most important festivity, Christ is born. So these angels are working hard to celebrate. It's something that gives you also some idea of what the ceremonies were in the contemporary Florence. And who is following the Magi? Well, it's apparently all the citizens, but some citizens are more important than others. And so in the first line, you have Cosimo himself, Piero, his elder son, and you have also an illegitimate son, Carlo, who is a priest in the Prato Cathedral. You see them closer. Cosimo, Carlo in between, and Piero. But in the amidst the crowd, there are children, and that's very unusual. And this child is Lorenzo il Magnifico. You can tell for sure, because it has the same look, you know, the elongated eyes, the nose with this peculiar shape. He had problems with his nose. He couldn't breathe so easily. And the lower lip is protruding. It's exactly how he will be. He will be uglier when he will grow, but even now is the record. And moreover, I have been in touch with this painting for years because I was supervising the conservation process of those frescoes. So I know each and every square meter, a square palm of it. And I was visiting the scaffolds with a famous dermatologist, and he noticed this. I don't know if you can see it. Is an imperfection, as a sort of how could it, nail,
mm-hmm. like a mole.
A mole, exactly. And this is throughout all his life in the same place with the same size, and even on the death mask that was molded after his face, he has the same exact the same mold in the same place. So he is Lorenzo as a child. But many other people in there, including Benozzo. Benozzo himself proudly said, is saying that he is the author. Opus Benozzi is written in his red hat in golden capital letters. Amidst the crowd, there are so many other people. I can't go on making hypotheses or showing what we are sure of, but that's the opposite wall where Melchior is riding. And here's Benozzo again. So he portrays himself two times. All those are citizens that we don't know exactly the name of whom, but probably they are allies and friends of the Medici family. We can perhaps recognize the Martelli with a typical elongated pointed face. And also this is probably a Capponi, the one with a big nose, and other citizens and agents of the Medici Bank are recognizable. We have to remember that those years, 1459, 1464, are the happiest in the life of the Medici household. They were all alive. They were at the top of the power and the richness, and they were apparently going to rule Florence in a hidden and discreet way forever. That didn't happen. In a few years, the second son of Cosimo died. One of the grandchildren also died. And in his senior years, Cosimo used to retire, to stay close by himself in the chapel, mourning and praying and telling this is a too big a house for too small a family. But not this year. This year of complete triumph and happiness. And again, the competition with Pallastrozzi is very clear. Here too, you have hunters, you have cheetahs or leopard or gepard. So it means that they are hunting in the Western way, like the noblemen used to do. You have the falcons, you have the rich suites, you have beautiful fabrics, you have all you have to have. Even a thoughtful monkey that is a sort of rival at a distance with the small animals that the Gentile da Fabriano painted in his wonderful Adoration of the Magi. So after all, the Medici won the battle, but the result is that we have, thanks to them and thanks to their rival Strozzi, wonderful masterpieces that you can admire, one in the galleries of the Uffizi, one in Washington, but the Journey of the Magi of the Chapel, where it used to be in its place. And I hope you can come to Florence, come back if you have already experienced the trip to Florence, and to visit in person this shrine of wonders that I tried briefly to visit with you. Thank you for your attention.
Wow, Christina, this is incredible. I have never noticed the angels collecting the flowers. You know, really? There's so many details. Yes, I mean, such a beautiful sight. And I was thinking about the rivalry between Palla Strozzi and Cosimo the Elder, and Palla is exiled. And I believe he lives a very long life. Was he staying in Padova or Bologna? I'm not sure, but he's somewhere a little bit north of Florence. And I think he every year is waiting for the Medicis to invite him back.
And they never did.
They never did. His wife dies, his children dies, and Paola lives on thinking that he must go back to his city, and he never did, which is, you know, such a tragedy.
Well, there were tough times, you know. You think of Dante Alighieri and died for all his life, and politics was not an easy game to play.
Yeah, it's true. Not an easy game, not even today. But, you know, just one more addition. Even though Lorenzo the Magnificent wasn't really a handsome man, I think women still loved him a lot. He was a ladies' man.
Right. He had an official lover, Lucrezia Donati, plus probably many other short stories.
Yes.
But he was incredibly seductive because of his bright spirit. He was a poet, and he was fascinating, probably, yes.
Yes, probably. So it's not always the looks, right?
No, but the look useful for me to recognize him among the other.
Incredible detail of his face. I mean, as a young man, that's really incredible. I'm sure other people have questions, so I don't want to, ask too many, but I wanted to say, did you prepare some slides for us to maybe show us a little bit of what is your favorite connection to Christmas in Florence?
Well, if you have still time and patience, I can show some very short parade of images, because
as
I was mentioning at the very beginning, in Florence, according to our ancient traditions, Epiphany, January 6th, was more important than Christmas. And so we developed traditions that the one is still alive, that is the ride of the Magi coming from the Medici company. And still in Florence, in the historical center, they are riding with a great company on January 6th at 12 o'clock, not 12, at 2 p.m. 2 p.m. And they cross the streets of Florence with drums and trumpets and all those beautiful dresses on. And then they revive the rites of the Magi.
Christina, I see from this picture that you are standing exactly in Paradiso. So you have a very privileged position in this photo.
Yes, the Porta del Paradiso, and the Paradiso is the space between the cathedral and the baptistry. Yes, they cross because they come from Pitti Palace, they cross the Arno River on the Ponte Vecchio, then all Piazza della Signoria with the Calzaioli, Dome, the baptistry, and then Palazzo Medici and San Marco, and that's where they stop. So there's a sort of a Medici revival that they are trying to show.
Do you think they will do
that? Can I say what I'm really impressed by in this case? The drums. The drums echoes and resonate so powerful, so full of solemn and also a little bit frightful. You know, you think of executions, so you think of those things that used to, and it's a sound that brings you back centuries, for centuries, and makes you feel part of a long story.
Wow.
I have some curious image. You may know that in Italian, Epiphania is a Greek word. Epiphania means to show. It's when Christ shows himself as the Son of God. So Epiphania means apparition, presentation, revelation. But people that didn't know Latin corrupted this term and it became Befana. It became Befana. Befana sounds like a woman name. And so here we have a real Befana. Befana is a sort of good witch that flies in the skies the night before Epiphany and brings gifts brings things to children that usually wait for with the socks empty and wait for Befana to fill them. And how does she fill those socks? Well, once again, according to tradition, some sweet things like candies, some nuts, tangerines that were at the time very rare and precious fruit, but also something less pleasant, onions, garlics, and coal. Because of the bad things that a kid can have committed throughout the years. So if you find a sweet thing, sometimes you can find also onions and coals. So that's my final remark. To get sweets and avoid coal, be good. And thank you again for your attention.
Oh, thank you. This is a very good message. But I think, you know, in this group, since everyone loves art and loves Florence, we're all good. I think we're all going to get our, you know, Befana's gift is going to be just sweets. Okay. So if you want to stop sharing your screen.
Yeah.
And I will, in the meantime, I will look at our, the questions.
Yes, please. If you have a question.
Eileen is asking, is it known who designed and executed the frame? I believe, Eileen, you're referring to the one by Gentile da Fabriano, which is mm-hmm. so impressive.
I never found a name for that carpenter work, certainly a first-rate workshop, because
yes.
It's really a sort of sculpture. Or more, it's more than that. It's a sort of architecture made in wood. I'm not sure that we know the name. Probably we don't. You know, usually they were simple workers, and we don't know much of them.
And it is incredible. Aioli
will become famous later in the century.
Yes. I think it's incredible how in Gentile's work you really see that he was trained as illuminator of holy books, because he fills every space given to him is filled with something beautiful. Gwen is asking, how did a painting by Fra Angelico and Filippo Lippi end up in the Washington, D.C.?
Unfortunately, it was sold. It was sold in the 19th century, as many other works of art that are scattered throughout the museums of the world, and especially in the States, where the Renaissance and primitive painter were really cherished. So it was legally exported.
How could that be? Because wasn't it a mandate by, what's her name, Maria, the last one, that everything had to stay in Florence?
I'm not sure I understood.
I think she was referring to Anna Maria de' Medici, who decides to leave all of the art in Florence.
Yes, Anna Maria was crucial to maintain the incredible heritage of the Medici family in Florence. But she could not keep everything. Of course, many other works of art were already sold or she couldn't stop them. But yes, I'm very grateful that you mentioned her, because she's my idol in a way. She's the one who really saved the constituency of Florence as a city of the arts. Otherwise, the Lothringen could have been dispersed everything everywhere.
Yeah.
And I have to make a small note, a legal note, if you allow me to do that. Sometimes you can hear or read that Anna Maria Luisa de' Medici donated all her incredible heritage, her legacy, to the city of Florence. It's not completely true. She donated it to the state. The state at the time was Tuscany. When Italy was really would happen in 1861, and then all the treasures of the Medici became state treasures because they belong to the state. And so the city of Florence is not the owner of those treasures, but is the place where they are supposed to stay. And they, of course, is very important, but just to stress this little big difference.
Christina, isn't it interesting how all the best laws are always made by women?
That's just a kidding. Very good point. Because, we cannot be, of course, too general. But what you understand, at least of Anna Maria de' Medici, is that it's a very specific desire of hers to leave everything in order, not to go away from this world, the living messy situations, to keep it clear for people of the next generations. And then I think she had no children, but she is like the mother of the city. And her idea is to give the city what she owned in order to put things in the right place. I like this idea very much.
And Christina also, to think about the tourists coming in, because she speaks in the letter that she has with the Lorraine family. She tells them, we wanted Florence to, also the people who visit to Florence to see this.
Absolutely, so absolutely.
The idea of people coming. Meryl Haber is asking, why did Maggi and Fabriano's paintings have halos around their heads?
Who has halo? The Magi.
In Fabriano. Well,
They were also considered saints, the concept of saint, being a saint was a bit, not strictly ruled, not yet. The whole process of canonization was still in on its way. I mean, sometimes you can find saints with a halo. They are not really saints. They are pious characters. They are good people, but not technically speaking, they are not saints.
Yes, yes. Does anyone else have any other questions as regards to the company of the Magi or adoration of the Magi? Because I see, Christina, do you see the comments as well? Do you see the chat?
I was trying to read the comments, yes.
Yes.
So flattering comments and appreciations, but I'm trying to find the questions.
One of the questions that came, which is not related to our topic today, but Gwen is asking, I read that the Sabine women cast room at the Academy has been redesigned. Can you talk a little bit about that? What was done and why? And also, do you know the Rape of the Sabine statue in the Loggia dei Lanzi will move to the Academia? Is that
the group of the Rape of the Sabine in the Accademia, the Galleria dell'Accademia, is a life-size group made with a raw plaster. I mean, is not earth. How do you call it? Earth?
Yeah, it's not terracotta, but it's plaster. Yeah.
Terra cruda.
Okay.
Oh. And was the model that Gian Bologna showed in order to have the commission assigned. And of course, it was not thrown away. It was in the Medici possession, and it ended up in the Accademia. That room has been redesigned, as it was mentioned, and was rearranged. But that's quite an unusual process. Every now and then you have to refurbish and to modify to get a better lighting system, or to change the labels, or put some virtual tools in it. So this is a sort of operation that was decided and performed by the directions of the direction of the Galleria dell'Accademia. Now, the real Rape of the Sabine, which is a group of marble, And it's heavily damaged by centuries of atmospheric traumas. It's still there. When I was in charge, I had many researches done, many technical and scientific tests, and it came out that it would be better to have it inside, but not there, not in the academia. In case they decide eventually to bring it into a closed and protected atmosphere, it would be in one of the huge halls at the ground floor of the Uffizi Gallery. So not far from the Loggia dei Lanzi. So it's a sort of adjustment. It is not an ideal condition, but when the statues cannot really go on in the open air, it's better to recover them. I should say, I would have done it if I had time. I retired and so I couldn't go on with this project, but I would recommend to put it in a more safe, in a safer environment.
I think it speaks so much about the talent and how wonderful of the artist John Bologna was, that the piece, even though it's outside for so many centuries, everything is still there, even her fingers, you know, up on the right. Top. Like, it was really incredible that it's in such a good shape still.
Well, I've been inspected in the closer.
Yes.
And if you make this movement on the head of the Roman or on the breast of the Sabina, you perceive there is a change of level.
Uh-huh.
Because the group, what is really tricky, is not in the open air. Not totally. It's half protected by the roof of the loggia and half in the open air. And so the rain has, and the wind as well, with the dust, have been eroding the surface, and you perceive a different level between the protected area and the exposed area. That's the worst thing that happens.
Wow, interesting. Sarah Morrison, Christina, Sarah Morrison was the U.S. Consul General in Florence.
Yes.
And the message is so wonderful to see you, Christina. I miss you and Florence so much. Could you please...
I'm so glad to have news of her.
Could you please explain a little more about the Guild of the Magi? Was it a union of artists or more religious or something else?
Well... Not exactly a union of artists, or a union of citizens under the leadership of the Medici family. And this kind of companies, compagnie laicali, lay secular companies, not religious, usually had aims and goals of mutual assistance or sharing the same devotion, going together to ceremonies. But especially this company had specific task to organize the Ride of the Magi that was performed on January 6th from San Marco, where they had a garden, the Medici garden, to work around the chariots, around the dresses, the masks, whatever was prepared for this big event. And from there, from San Marco to the cathedral, of course, walking and riding under the windows of the Medici Palace. So this company had as a main goal to organize this festivity and this ceremonies.
Christina, were the Magi Medici themselves? Would the three Magi, would they actually be the Medici? Would they reenact them or no?
Not in the healing meaning, no. They were sapienti, they were wise men, they were learned men, and also perhaps a sort of, magus?
The magi. Un vero
mago,
okay.
Uno stregone, un sorcerer.
Sorcerer.
The sorcerer has a bad meaning. I mean, they were... In the good sense, something more than literati or learned people, but not that we know that they had healing faculties. No,
yeah,
the protection of the Medici family under the point of view from the healing point of view were two other saints, Cosmas and Damian. These were from Syria. They were martyrs of the fourth century Christian era. And they were two brothers that used to heal people for free. They were, in the Greek term, anargyri. They didn't get money for their profession. So they were ideal for protecting the Medici, who were bankers and were so rich. That was a good idea to have them as protectors.
So basically, when they would reenact, when they would accompany the Magi, when they started it with the Medici family, would the Medicis themselves be in the procession?
Absolutely. They were at the head of the procession.
So would they have been the
Magi?
Okay, so they would have been the Magi.
Exactly. Okay. So the identification is really very, very strict.
Exactly, exactly. That is what I meant, yes. Okay. And Christina, who is in the charge of the procession today? Who is organizing the procession?
Association under the aegis of the city of Florence.
It's okay.
Half private, half public organization. All the people that take part in it are volunteers, and very often they offer this wonderful dress. They prepare themselves, they pay for the fabrics, and they're very proud of it.
Yes, many of my friends are actually part of it. So it's an amazing sight. Do you think they will do it in the next January? Do you think there will be procession?
No, I'm sure that this year, you see, it's crowded. It's both on the side of the retinue, but also the audience viewer. Is crowded. Yeah. No, it's not safe, unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately. Anyway, Christina, if you want to take a look, there is more questions, more beautiful comments. People are thanking you.
Oh, yes, because... thank you. I'm sorry that I cannot...
I will send you the copy of all of the comments, okay?
Oh, so you can very read. Nice of you. Thank
but basically
you.
Everyone is saying that you are the gift for this Christmas. You gave us all a gift this Christmas season. So
can I ask Ruby Moreno, can I quote your private remark?
What Ruby? Is she write?
Am I allowed, Ruby? I don't know.
Yes, of course.
Of course. She's telling, thank you, Christina, and thank you. Your hair is beautiful, love the color. Thank you so much, because you are a great, supporter of my choice not to do anything. I mean, the white hair coming out, and I keep them as they are. So thank you, because I wonder sometimes if I should do something and to have a bright color or something, but then I'm too lazy for it.
You look wonderful, Christina.
Thank you.
Anyway, is there any other questions in the audience? If you want to unmute yourselves, please do. And if not, I feel everyone is, it was absolutely wonderful, Christina.
Oh, thank you for being so patient and supportive.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Paola.
Thank you.
Grazie.
Thank you very much for doing this.
Thank you all. Thank you all. It was such a pleasure to share an hour of serenity and joy.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, thank you. Bye-bye.
Grazie mille. Buon Natale. Buon Natale. Buone feste.
Grazie, Elena.
Thank you all.
Okay.
Have a nice Christmas time.
Is Sarah, are you still with us? Sarah Morrison?
Yes, Sarah is there. I see her.
You see, yeah.
Hi.
It was so nice to see you again.
You are beautiful. Don't change your hair. It looks wonderful.
I see that you are a real supporter of my choice.
You see how white mine is. How do you think, Christina, that the city is going to recover from all of this loss of revenue during this time?
That's a question, a real question. We don't know. Certainly tough times are ahead, very tough, because the city invested perhaps too much, as you know perfectly, in the tourism business. When you don't have an alternative and the tourism stops suddenly, it's really difficult to go ahead, to go on.
I know they're thinking about other kinds of ways to try to have a more diverse economy. And I've listened into a couple of sessions that happen to be public, but it just sounds, I mean, it's exciting in one way that maybe the tourism industry can change. And yet in another way, it seems as if all of our countries are in such debt, but I know Italy started off that way terribly. And now it's just got to be struggling so much. It can be depressing if we let it be, but I guess we must be feeling positive that we'll all recover.
Sara, you're right. And it's also very true that we have to refocus the general attitude and to think of new professions or new ways of working. But it's something that can't happen in a few weeks or months.
Years, yeah.
And although we all have strong hopes in the vaccines, nevertheless, nothing will start to be as it used to be in short time. It will take years, perhaps. I don't know.
But please stay with it. Please keep going.
Yes. All of us have to keep going. And thank you again for listening and being so friendly and supportive. Sara, good luck.
Again.
Thank you, Paola. Once again, thank you. I hope I didn't disappoint you.
No, how can that ever be? You're absolutely wonderful as always. And I look forward to your new talks and seeing you in person and listening to everything, all the new lectures, and also visiting you in Accademia del Disegno and, seeing the Dio Fluviale in person. I think it's going to be a treat.
Please consider you are all invited to visit the room with me or with us, and virtually or physically. Anyway, we will do it together. So thank you again, and bye.
Christina, thank you for your time. Buon Natale, buone feste. Thanks everyone for tuning in. I look forward to seeing some of you in my masterclass this coming week or next year. We will have many other great speakers. The next speaker I do have confirmed for January is my dear professor, Gary Radke.
Oh, yes.
Another treat.
It's wonderful. It's so lovely.
Yes.
Glad to know that.
So, bye. Grazie mille. Buone feste. Happy New Year.
Bye. May your stocking be filled with tangerines and sweets and nuts.
That's a real wish.
Bye-bye.
Bye, all.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Paola.
Thank you, Christina.
We love
Paola,
you.
We will keep in touch anyhow.
Yes. I love you. Bye. Thank you so much.
Ciao.
Bye-bye now. Later.